What's up, everybody? Steven here with Neural DSP, and today I have another Artist Tones video for you. So today we're talking about Jerry Cantrell. He's one of the founding members of Alice in Chains, performing on guitar and vocals, and I don't think that it's hyperbole to say that he's one of the great rock icons. Since its inception, Alice in Chains has earned 9 Grammy nominations and several gold, platinum, and multi-platinum albums. The tone of Alice in Chains helped shape a generation of musicians. So with that being said, let's go ahead and start breaking down some aspects of Jerry's tone. For amplifiers, Jerry's mentioned in a couple of interviews that the first two Alice in Chains albums, his main amplifier was a Marshall modded by Bogner. This started a relationship with Bogner that lasted several years and included the use of the Bogner Fish preamp, the Ubershaw, and the Shiva, to name a few. Around 2008-2009, in preparation for the album Black Gives Way to Blue, Jerry contacted Dave Friedman about building him his own amp head. He ended up with two prototypes, the Friedman Marsha, one called Mad and the other called Pissed. The naming scheme in place just to describe the aggression and intensity one had over the other, Pissed being the more aggressive tone, obviously. These amps went out to separate cabinets, one having a 4x12 full of greenbacks, the other a 4x12 full of vintage 30s. Now Jerry has his own signature amp head with Friedman called the Double J 100 watt head with EL34 power tubes. He uses two of these amp heads in his live rig, set up similarly to his Mad and Pissed, where one is dialed in a little bit more aggressively than the other. For his guitars, Jerry has been known to use G&L for his main acts. He uses a couple of signature models as well as the original G&Ls he bought around 1985. The cool thing is the design of these guitars is very similar to Van Halen's Frankenstein guitar, since Van Halen was a big influence on Jerry early in his career. His guitars are generally equipped with the Awayu humbuckers from Motor City Pickups. In the past, he has been known to use the Seymour Duncan Jeff Beck humbuckers though. In addition to his G&L collection, he has been known to use Gibson Les Pauls, Gibson SGs, and Fender Telecasters. So now let's go ahead and pick apart some of these tones. And I recorded all these riffs on my ESP LTD Eclipse, which has the 8185 active humbucking set. So after researching Jerry's gear, I had an idea of which plugins I wanted to use, but I actually struck out a few times at first. I tried the Nolly, didn't work. I tried the Pliny, didn't work. I tried the NTS, nah. I almost thought that I was gonna have to ditch this idea for a video, but then I turned on the Fortin Nameless and it just clicked. The first track is probably one of their most well-known songs, Man in the Box, off of the album Facelift. Just to give you an idea of how close I came to just nixing this entire video idea, here's what the default Fortin Nameless sounds like on Man in the Box. So it's not a pretty close off the bat. So Jerry uses a wah and a talk box in this song, but just for simplicity's sake, I dialed in just a basic rhythm tone. Now here is the tone that I dialed in for Man in the Box. So the really important part to dialing in your tones like this is always to get the impulse response first. So you can imagine my process where I pulled up every single plugin one by one and then went through every single impulse response one by one to hear how close I could get the tone to Man in the Box's original guitar tone. So eventually I pulled up the Fortin Nameless and I turned on the Dynamic 57 and it sounded pretty good. I ended up complementing it with the Dynamic 906. After that, I came over to my pedal section, I turned off the grind pedal. I messed around with the hex drive, but I didn't particularly like how much saturation it was giving the tone. And then going to the head section, I pulled the master volume control out and I boosted it all the way, pulling down the output gain just so I can compensate the volume difference. I boosted the bass, mid, and treble and then just tweaked the gain knobs until I liked how much saturation I was getting. Now my tone might be just a little bit brighter to my ear than the original tracks, but it still sounds pretty close. So the next track is Them Bones off of the album Dirt. Now when you listen to this track, there's probably a lot more saturation on the guitars and probably far more guitar layers than Man in the Box. So as always, the first thing that I do is go to the impulse response section. And since I copied my settings from the first track to the second track, I still had my Dynamic 57 and 906 set up. After that, it was just a matter of tweaking laterally the position so that way it was either brighter or darker as I needed it to be. I actually ended up using the hex drive for this just to get the extra drive and saturation. And you can see I darkened up the tone and boosted the level a little bit so that it pushed into the amp a little bit harder. And then I get to the head section and I still have the master volume control pulled out and boosted all the way to the top. I have the bass and the mid boosted, but I don't have the treble boosted because it was just already a little bit too bright for my taste in comparison to the original track. So this last track is called Stone and it's off the album The Devil Put Dinosaurs Here. Now this song is a great representation of Jerry's usage of bends during your rhythm guitar playing. So since Jerry has changed his equipment between the first two examples and this one, I felt it was necessary to go back and retool some of the settings in the Fortin Nameless. So in the impulse response section, I went with the Dynamic 906 paired with the Ribbon 121. The 121 is a little bit warmer in tone compared to the previous pairing, which was the 906 and the 57. For the pedal section, I went with the hex drive again and I pushed the drive all the way up, the tone a little bit down, and I wanted to drive the signal into the head section just a little bit from here. And then in the head section, I actually backed off the master volume control just a little bit to take a little bit of the warmth out. I dropped the bass, I boosted the mid and the treble, and then I went with the low setting, which bypassed this second gain knob. So that's how I would dial in a Jerry Cantrell rhythm tone. I was personally pretty surprised when the Nameless actually filled in my needs so well, but I will say that this wasn't particularly an easy one. I still feel like there's a lot that I could probably do to tweak the tone even closer to the original. I even had to re-record my take a number of times just because the feel of his right hand is difficult to replicate. And Jerry wasn't the only talent in the band, but his hands and his creativity contributed to creating a tone that defined the rock genre for over three decades. So coming away from this, I have a better understanding on how to dial in certain tones, but I also come away with a greater respect for Jerry Cantrell as a player, as a creative mind, and as a songwriter. I think one of the reasons why I really enjoy doing this series is I get to learn just as much as you guys just by doing the research on these artists. So I hope that you enjoy it. Let me know how close I got in the comments down below. Thank you so much for checking out this video. Please like, share, and subscribe, and hit that bell icon for notifications on when we upload our videos. Comment down below. Let me know what artist or band you want me to dial in next. Let me know if you're enjoying this content. It helps me out a lot to get that sort of feedback. And as always, I'll see you in the next video.